Good morning. Welcome to worship here at Horizon. It is good to see all of you here this morning as we continue to celebrate the fact that our Lord and Savior Christ has risen. If you are a guest with us this morning, a special welcome to you. We would love to have you fill out one of our guest cards just to let us know that you were here and how we might get in touch with you, how we might minister to your family. But again, welcome to all of you. I invite you now to stand and make each other feel welcome as we begin our time of worship together. If you will, join with me in looking at our announcements this morning. A couple of notes of congratulations. Congratulations to all those who were baptized last Sunday. It was a wonderful time of worship. And congratulations to Lauren and Zach on the birth of their daughter, and to Alexa and her husband as well on the birth of their son. Babies everywhere, a wonderful, wonderful thing. On the notes of celebration, coming up, we will have our annual baby child dedication on Mother's Day. If you have a name of a baby or small children to be included on that special day, I would encourage you to let the church office know as soon as possible. And also on Sunday, May 26th, we will be celebrating graduate recognition. So if you have someone who needs to be recognized on that day, I would encourage you to let the office know as soon as possible as well. Congratulations to OG and Nancy on their marriage. And coming up on May 19th at 3 o'clock in the fellowship hall, we will have a celebration for them. So I hope that you will mark that on your calendars and plan to attend. And then coming up at the end of May, we will have a church-wide cookout and volleyball to celebrate the coming of summer. I hope you get that on your calendar, and I hope by now you've already got Bible school on your calendar, but it's in June 10th through the 13th. So get all those things on your calendar so you don't miss out. We got a lot of things to celebrate and enjoy and opportunities for fellowship, and I hope that you'll take part in all of them. Thank you.
Our opening hymn is hymn number 581. Please stand as we sing together. I love to tell the story.
Thank you. All the children come forward, please. Good morning. So, if when you think of a heart, what do you think of? What word pops in your mind? Very good. Yeah, I think of love too. And the Bible says a lot about love. And one verse is 1 John 4:11, and it says, "Beloved, since God loved us so much, we ought to love one another." So this verse tells us that God loves us, and we know that God loves us because he sent Jesus, right? And that he cares for us, and that God sent Jesus into this world so our sins can be forgiven, and Jesus was here to teach us how to live and to love others. Love begins with God, and God showed us how to love others. And God is love, and the way we act and the words we say should show others God's love. You know? So who are we to love? We're to love everybody, right? We're supposed to love our family, our friends, our classmates, our teachers, even those we don't necessarily get along with. But we can show love to others by the way we treat them. We can respect them. We can help them out if they need help. We can love others by the choices we make, and by being a true friend at all times. So as you're with your family and your friends and y'all are at school this week, I want you to think about the way you treat other people, okay? And think about what you say and what you do and ask yourselves, is this the way God wants me to show them his love? All right? Let's pray. God, please help us love others the way you want us to love others. Teach us how to love each other each and every day. In your name we pray. Amen. Go get that
money. Please stand for our next hymn, number 570.
Thank you.
Our scripture for this morning comes from the book of Acts, chapter 5, verses 27 through 32. When they had brought them, they had them stand before the council, and the high priest questioned them, saying, "We gave you strict orders not to teach in his name, the name of Jesus. Yet here you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching, and you were determined to bring this man's blood on us." But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than any human authority. The God of our ancestors raised up Jesus, whom you had killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him at his right hand as leader and savior, that he might give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses to these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him."
Please stand for our offertory hymn, number 443.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this glorious, beautiful day to come and to worship you. We thank you for those who are here, those who are visiting. Lord, we just pray that you will have your hand on all of those who are not here for whatever reason, Lord. Help us to be the witnesses in this world that we need to be. Bless these tithes and these offerings so that we may further your kingdom here in this county and across this world. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Please stand for the doxology.
Children are invited, if they wish, to attend Children's Church with Katie. She's back there in the back. Of you love a good surprise? Yeah, a good one. And not surprises in general, but good ones. We I would like to think we all do, because a good surprise has a way of pulling us out of the slump of the ordinary everyday lives. You know, we can be going along all ho-hum and boom, a good surprise pulls us out of the doldrums and can turn a whole day, week, even a year around. Last Sunday on Easter, we celebrated the greatest surprise in the history of the world. The surprise of an empty tomb on Easter morning. The surprise of the resurrection of Christ. After Christ had been beaten, berated, and killed in front of so many, he defeated death and emerged alive. Surprise, surprise. And that surprise changed the course of human history. And it set into motion a long list of surprises by God in the work of the world. Surprises that God is still up to this very day. Today we began a new series titled Surprise, Surprise, as we begin to look at surprises, particularly surprises from the book of Acts, surprising acts of God in and through the earliest Christians. The book of Acts is organized around the command of Jesus that's found in Acts 1:8. You've sung it this morning. You've heard it sung. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And the stories in the book of Acts are organized in a way that they show that progression of how the power of the gospel spreads. And along the way, those stories are surprising. And if we hear them anew, they may just surprise us too. My hope is that these surprises will awake in us a desire to be surprised, a desire to join in with God's surprising work in the world, and that maybe, just maybe, we will become a people who hope to be surprised, a people who expect the unexpected. In our text today, what we are given is a look at the surprising transformation that is possible with Christ through the lens of Peter. If we think about Peter's story and we rewind a little bit into the Gospels, his boldness in the text that we read this morning is quite the surprising turnaround. If we draw out a timeline of Peter's life, what we will discover is that many of his starring moments in the Gospels are him not having a whole lot of confidence in himself or in Jesus. For example, we have the story of Peter out fishing and failing. And Jesus comes up and says, cast your nets to the other side of the boat. And good old cynical Peter thinks, what good is that going to do? I've been out here all night, hadn't caught a thing, and now you're telling me all I got to do is fish on the other side of the boat. Yeah, right. Or the same Peter who, when confronted with a crowd of thousands who were hungry, comes up to Jesus and says, Jesus, we don't have anything to eat. We've got all these people. They're starving. Send them home so they can eat. We don't need to deal with that. This is the same Peter who, when push came to shove, leading up to Jesus' execution, denied even knowing Jesus. Not once, not twice, but three times. When you lay out Peter's life like that, he doesn't exactly sound like the rock on which Jesus said, I'm going to build my church. But yet Peter was surprised in all of those situations and many more. Imagine how he must have felt when he pulled those nets up on that boat and they were full. Or when Jesus said, ah, we can feed this crowd, no problem, and had leftovers. Or especially when Jesus rose from the dead. But the most surprising thing may have been when Jesus pulled Peter aside, and despite all those times of coming up short, of lacking faith and confidence in Jesus, Christ comes to Peter, and instead of firing him and says, never mind, you're not my rock, he tells him, you're the guy. Feed my sheep. You've got this. See, all of those surprises worked together to fuel a transformation in Peter. He goes from one who lacks in trust and confidence in the Lord to one who boldly proclaims the Lord as a powerful witness, no matter what stood in front of him. Surprise. In our text, Peter and the other apostles, they have been out preaching in Jerusalem and they have kicked the proverbial hornet's nest. They've gotten themselves into a world of trouble, so much so that they've been thrown in prison. We didn't read it this morning, but they wind up in prison, and then through a miraculous intervention on the behalf of God, an angel breaks them out of prison. Now, if we have been thrown into prison for preaching and an angel breaks us out, one would think, all right, I ain't going to do that again. I'm going to go the other way. But what Peter and the apostles do is they go right to the temple, the home of the religious authorities who had them locked up, and they start preaching right in their front yard, like, here we are. That's a gutsy move, or a crazy move, probably a little bit of both. But instead of lacking the confidence that he had earlier, Peter says, I've got to obey God. He's been transformed from one who runs away to one who serves as a witness. He has been transformed. And these authorities that were out to get Peter and the other apostles, their whole problem was grounded in the fact that they were jealous. They were envious of the dazzling success that the Holy Spirit was having through Peter and these apostles. They were at work bringing the message of hope and healing in Christ to the world, and in so doing was questioning the power of the powers that be. And they wanted to squelch that out as quickly as possible, just like they had sought to get rid of Jesus. But Peter knew in the face of the surprising resurrection of Christ that there wasn't anything at this point that was going to hold them back. They were witnesses. They weren't simply observers, but they were a people who must actively make known what they had seen. They had been surprised and in turn were going to surprise the world. Their encounter with Christ had changed them, and it left them with no choice but to change the world. There's a story told of Clarence Jordan when he visited an integrated church in the Deep South. Jordan was surprised to find a relatively large church that was integrated, not only black and white, but also rich and poor in the early 60s. In a little rural, a large country church in a rural area nonetheless. So Jordan asked the old country preacher, "How did you get the church this way?" "What way?" the preacher asked. Jordan went on to explain his surprise at finding a church so integrated in the rural South in that time period. And the preacher said, "Well, when our preacher left our little old church, I went to the deacons and said, 'I reckon I'll be the preacher.' And the first Sunday as a preacher, I opened the book and read, 'As many of you as has been baptized into Jesus has put on Jesus, and there is no longer any Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, males or females, because you all is one in Jesus.' Then I closed the book, and my sermon went like this: 'If you are one with Jesus, you are one with all kind of folk. And if you ain't, well, you ain't. Amen.'" Jordan asked, "Well, what happened after that?" "Well," the preacher said, "the deacons took me in the back and told me they didn't want to hear that kind of preaching no more." "Then what happened?" asked Clarence. "Well," said the old country preacher, "I preached that church right down to 4 people. But not long after that, something surprising happened. It grew and it grew. And what I found out was that revival sometimes don't mean bringing people in, but getting them out that don't dare to love Jesus." The story was told in the book by Stanley Hauerwas, Where Resident Aliens Live, from an interview that Clarence gave a long time ago. Now, ain't that a surprising church growth plan? Now, I don't plan on that being my story. I ain't trying to run anybody off or get run off myself. But I tell it because it makes the point that sometimes God works in surprising ways. God works in ways that run counterintuitive to everything we think we know. The surprising work of God turns up in our lives and can lead us to surprise ourselves, to do surprising things when we act in faith. Things we don't expect, things which work opposite of how we think they're going to work, and yet God shows up and surprises us. That's what happens when we dare to love Jesus and live according to God's calling, as opposed to listening to all the other forces in this world that crave our attention. If Peter and the apostles had backed down, the gospel may not have made it out of Jerusalem. If that old country preacher had backed down in the face of pressure to remain segregated, that church may not have made it. Each and every day we are challenged to make a choice. The challenge to discern and act upon what we believe is obedience to God rather than obedience to anything else. The choice for us is, will we live our lives directed by faith, transformed by the surprising power of Christ, or will we live directed by the fear and cynicism offered by the world, and in turn develop the inward-focused, selfish mentality that arises from living in fear? In our lives, in every relationship, our own witness is tied to how much our lives reflect the surprisingly transformative power of Christ. In the same way that the disciples, like Peter, were transformed to preach in the face of danger, we too can be transformed. We can be transformed to befriend strangers, to include those on the fringes of society, to live with joy in the face of all the troubles of the world. As that old country preacher in Clarence's story said, we can be one with Jesus and with all kind of folk. Not because we deny that the world is troubled, but because we are a people who are surprised by hope. A hope that God's love and life aren't stopped by injustice and evil, but rather the power of God has the power to overcome those forces. If in our lives, in this day and age, there's so many different facets of our lives. It's everyday life and work life and church life and social media life. But if every part of our life, or any part for that matter, expresses the same fear and cynicism and negativity and hate and the hostility of the world, how is anyone, if any of that mess is present in our life, how is anyone going to believe our witness to the surprising power of Christ's resurrection? If we're living in fear and cynical and disgruntled and hateful like everybody else, is anyone going to believe us when we tell them that we've experienced a powerful, surprising transformation? No. They're going to dismiss anything we have to say and anything we have to offer is hypocritical. Nothing we say about Christ will be heard or believed. But instead, it is our ability to love, to hold on to hope, to have faith, even in a scary world, that's the true mark of a surprising transformation. That's the true mark of believing in the power of resurrection. I read a story a while back of a couple who had planned a small family wedding in their Baptist church. And the wedding was on Saturday night. Only problem was there'd been an all-day missions conference at the church that day. And the family only had about an hour between when the conference ended and when the wedding was supposed to happen to clean up and decorate the church. It was only after receiving her wedding photos that the bride discovered a surprise. There, across the front wall of the church, in nearly every photo was a huge banner that said, "Worth the risk." What a surprising but oddly appropriate thing to find in your wedding photos. But surprises lead to surprising transformation. Surprising transformation requires discernment, wisdom, and yes, risk. Learning how to fully trust God in the face of our fears does require risk. It requires something of us. It requires a choice. The choice to be willing to step out on faith. To be willing to be surprised, to expect to be surprised, to expect the unexpected. You know, ours is a deep truth. And when we speak it with love and with conviction, it has the power to transform burdens and change people's lives. Those who look at us as Christians, what they need to see is an expression of the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. They need to see that that transforming power is real. Because it's faith that surprises. Faith tells us to be patient when everything else tells us to panic. Faith tells us to hold on when everything else says give up. Faith tells us to keep moving forward when everything else tells us to stop or to go back. When we are truly transformed by resurrection, we just may be surprised at what Christ can do with us. So how will you let the power of Christ surprise you, transform you this week and beyond? Maybe it will be a surprising act of kindness to a stranger, surprising yourself at your ability to do it, and opening the door for God to surprise you with their response. Maybe it will be surprising everyone and saying something positive about someone whom you normally wouldn't say anything positive about. Maybe it will be intentionally looking for the good things and accentuating the positives in your life and being surprised by the blessings you already have. Expect the unexpected. Take a risk. It might mean stepping out of your comfort zone and inviting someone to church instead of worrying about, oh, they'll say no, or what will they think of me. Maybe it's time to surprise yourself by stepping out on faith to join the church or commit your life to Christ or be baptized, whatever the case may be. But I'm absolutely convinced that God has surprises in store for us. May we be a people who look to be surprised, but also a people who are willing to do things which are surprising. May we experience the surprisingly transformative power of Christ. Amen.
Hymn number 509, please stand.
Reflect on John's message, if you would pray with me. Lord God, we do just ask that you transform us, that so often we become like the world. We become afraid and mean and just again living the way the world lives around us, and we just pray that we would have the courage to be like the apostles, Lord, and to change, to be empowered by you, to be transformed by you. And Lord, that's what your word promises. That's what you did in Acts, and that's what you're doing today if we allow you to be that in our lives. So I pray that for our church, God, that we would be open-hearted and, again, allowing you to energize us and follow you. And so, again, we ask that in your name, that you would transform us and use us, Lord, in your name. Amen.